Dear students, today I am going to deliver a lecture on time-independent Schrödinger equation. I am Sridhar R, Assistant Professor of Physics, Government Women's College, Tumkur. So now let us start the derivation of the time-independent Schrödinger equation. For which we have to consider a particle in any system or in any state. So the particle has a mass m and which is moving with a velocity v, and we know that in the previous semester we have discussed about the de Broglie's theory. De Broglie's theory says that any particle which is under motion, it exhibits the wave-like properties and has the wavelength lambda is equal to h divided by p, where h is the Planck constant and p is the momentum of that particle. The same concept we can apply in this case for a particle in any state or in any system. Then the wavelength associated with that particle, according to the de Broglie's theory, we can write lambda is equal to h divided by p. We can call this is the equation number one. Then we have to consider the wave function for that state. Whatever the particle we are considered in a state, so we have to be consider the wave function for that state, which describes the de Broglie wave for that particle which is moving along positive x direction. So the equation for that is psi is equal to a into e to the power of I into kx minus omega t. So here you can observe the psi is the wave function and a is any arbitrary constant. And the term, exponential term, e to the power of I into kx minus omega t is a sinusoidal function, or it is a periodic function, because e to the power of ix is in a complex notation, it is imaginary part of the number, complex number. So therefore, psi is equal to a into e to the power of I into kx minus omega t is the equation for a wave function which describes the wavelength, describes the de Broglie wave for a particle. So therefore we can call this is the equation number two. Now you know that a is a constant, and in the term k is a wave number. So wave number k is equal to 2 pi by lambda, and omega is the angular frequency. Then we have to be differentiate the equation 2 with respect to the time. We have the equation 2, differentiate once, we will get the d psi divided by dt, which is equal to a into e to the power of, wherever the t is there, here omega t, so I into omega t, you have to be differentiate e to the power of I into kx minus omega t into minus I omega. If you differentiate again, you will get a into e to the power of I into kx minus omega t. Already the minus I omega is there. So once again it is minus I omega. So minus into minus plus I squared omega squared. So therefore, and also we know that I squared is equal to minus 1, because I is equal to square root of minus 1. So therefore, we got the expressions by differentiating the equation 2 with respect to time. We get d squared psi divided by dt squared is equal to minus omega squared, minus omega squared into a into e to the power of I into kx minus omega t. In the bracket, whatever the term is there, the term is equal to psi. From the equation 2, the term in the bracket is equal to psi. So then therefore d squared psi divided by dt squared is equal to minus omega squared psi. Now we can call this is the equation number 3, and also we have the equation for traveling wave, because here what we are considered the particle in a system which is traveling. So therefore, as per the concept of the wave motion, we have the equation for a traveling wave, and the expression or the equation for the traveling wave is d squared y divided by dx squared, which is equal to 1 divided by v squared into d squared y divided by dt squared. Here you know that y is the displacement and v is the velocity of that particle or the wave in general. Therefore, we can apply the same analogy to the case of the particle what we have considered previously, and it is a de Broglie wave. So the same analogy can be applied to the de Broglie wave. So therefore, the equation is reduces to d squared psi divided by dx squared, which is equal to 1 divided by v squared into d squared psi divided by dt squared. The same, wherever the y is there, we have substituted the psi. Now we can call this is the equation number 4. This equation represents the wave. So the previous expression d squared y divided by dx squared is equal to 1 divided by v squared into d squared y divided by dt squared. That is the traveling wave. The same concept, the same analogy we are applied to the particle in this case. So therefore, this represents the wave which is propagating along the x-axis with a velocity v, and psi will be the displacement of the particle at any instant of time t. Therefore, from the equation 3 and 4, we can write, so compare the equation previous expression, the d squared psi divided by dt squared. We have the equation 3 is the d squared psi divided by dt squared, which is equal to minus omega squared psi. So therefore, in the place of d squared psi divided by dt squared in the equation 4, we have to be substitute by minus omega squared psi. So therefore, the equation 4 is reduced to d squared psi divided by dx squared, which is equal to minus omega squared psi divided by v squared. So, and also we know that so here the particle exhibits the wave-like properties. So therefore, it has the wavelength and it has the frequency. So let us consider the lambda is the wavelength and nu is the frequency of that wave. Then we have the relations. Already we know that omega is equal to 2 pi nu, 2 pi into the frequency of that wave, that v is the angular frequency, and v is the velocity of that wave, v is equal to nu lambda. So nu is the frequency and lambda is the wavelength. So then, so using these relations, we can write the above expression, the previous expression, d squared psi divided by dx squared is equal to minus, in the place of omega, we are substituted 2 pi nu whole square divided by, in the place of lambda, in the place of v, we have substituted the nu lambda. So v squared is the nu lambda whole squared into psi. Here nu and nu get cancelled. So here nu square and nu square will get cancelled. The remaining is minus 4 pi squared divided by lambda squared into psi. We can here d squared psi divided by dx squared is equal to minus 4 pi squared divided by lambda squared into psi. For our convenient and for the next equation, for the next derivation, we want 1 divided by lambda square. So therefore, we have to write 1 divided by lambda square. So by rearranging the terms, we'll get the 1 divided by lambda square. That will be equal to minus 1 divided by 4 pi squared psi into d squared psi divided by dx squared. So you can call this is the equation number 5. And also we know that the particle of mass m v with the velocity v, which is moving, then it has some kinetic energy. The kinetic energy, usually we represent the Ek, so that is equal to half m e square. So you know that half m e square can be written in terms of momentum of the particle. So therefore, we have to be multiplied and divided by the mass of the particle. Then we'll get the half m square v square divided by m. So we know that the potential, the p, momentum of the particle, p is equal to mv. So therefore, p squared divided by 2m. This is the kinetic energy. You can call this is the equation number 6. And also, we can express this equation 6 in terms of the wavelength. So by substituting, the p is equal to h divided by lambda. So in the equation 1, we are defined the wavelength of the particle, lambda is equal to h divided by p. The same, by rearranging the term, we will get the momentum, p is equal to h divided by lambda. So we can substitute that in the equation number 6. Then we have the equation for the kinetic energy of that particle, Ek is equal to 1 divided by 2m. In the place of p, substituted h divided by lambda, so therefore h square divided by lambda square. This is equation number 7. And we have the equation number 5 and 7, you can observe. So in the equation 7, 1 divided by lambda square is there. For that 1 divided by lambda square, we have to be substitute the equation 5. So by substituting the equation 5 in 7, we will get the kinetic energy Ek is equal to. So by just we are writing the 1 divided by 2m and h squared as it is, and in the for the 1 divided by lambda square, we are substituting minus 1 divided by 4 pi squared psi into d squared psi divided by dx squared. So by multiplying all those terms, you will get the kinetic energy Ek is equal to minus. Here minus is there. I forgot to write the minus. You can write again. Ek is equal to minus h squared divided by 8 pi squared m psi into d squared psi divided by dx squared. You can call this is equation number 8. And also, we know that, so we are considered the particle in any space or in the state. So where there may be present a field, any field, it may be a gravitational field or an electric field or whatever may be there. So due to that field, this particle may acquire some energy called the potential energy. So therefore, the particle may possess the potential energy. So let us take V is the potential energy possessed by the particle at any instant of time, at any depending on its position. So then the total energy of the particle is V is equal to Ek plus V, kinetic energy into potential energy. We have the expression for kinetic energy. You can write minus h squared divided by 8 pi squared m psi to d squared psi divided by dx squared plus potential energy V. By rearranging the terms, by taking the potential V to the right hand side, we will get this expression. Or we can write by keeping d squared psi divided by dx squared in the left hand side and bringing h squared divided by 8 pi squared m into psi to the right hand side, we'll get the d squared psi divided by dx squared is equal to minus 8 pi squared m divided by h squared into e minus p into psi. Or we can write the d squared psi divided by dx squared plus 8 pi squared m divided by h squared into e minus p into psi is equal to 0. This equation is called the one dimensional time independent Schrodinger equation. This is why we call this is the one dimensional, because the particle in the system is traveling along the x direction. So therefore, the only one space variable can be considered. So therefore, this is called the one dimensional time independent Schrodinger equation. Suppose if we consider the particle is in a space of all the three coordinates, then we have to be express this equation in terms of three dimension. So therefore, for a three dimension, so the wave function psi is a function of all the three variables x, y, z. So therefore, we have to be right dou squared here. I written d squared psi divided by dx squared. Actually, we have to be right the dou squared psi divided by dou x squared plus dou squared psi by dou x squared plus dou squared psi by dou z squared plus 8 pi squared m divided by h squared into e minus v into psi is equal to 0. Or in terms of Laplacian operator, the term d squared psi by dx squared plus d squared psi by dy squared plus d squared psi by dz squared, which is equal to del squared psi, that is Laplacian of the wave function psi, plus 8 pi squared m divided by h squared into e minus v into psi is equal to 0. Or in terms of h cross also, we can express h cross is equal to h divided by 2 pi. So by rearranging the term, we'll get the expression del squared psi plus 2m divided by h cross per e minus v into psi is equal to 0. So this is the three-dimensional time-independent Schrodinger equation. So this is very important derivation for the examination point of view. So you can work out and success in examination. Okay, thank you.